We have, I think, a much brighter and rosier outlook than has been portrayed. We have institutions that are growing. We are on lists all the time, from CNN.com to NBC to all these other things, talking about our home values, our quality of life. Our census numbers did not decline, unlike the two other cities that we get grouped in with, upstate, the thruway cities. So we have been fortunate to be at a place in time where we've been able to pivot to a new economy, thinking about manufacturing for green infrastructure, thinking about innovation and matching our public institutions and our private institutions so that we can have innovation in the industries that make sense for us. The problems, the challenges, though, are immense, and they are legacy challenges by and large. I've heard a lot of people recently, it's interesting, talking about comparing themselves or their institution to GM at the time when GM had all of these legacy problems. And I really think the comparison is apt for the upstate cities. When you look at what is driving our costs, it is policy that is set by Albany. So as a mayor, when I look at trying to control costs or being able to make investments in certain areas, maybe not invest in other areas or actually cut back, I don't have that ability, because what happens is I get bills from Albany. We call it mandates. Pensions is one that is going to drive not just the city of Syracuse, not just upstate cities, but all cities in New York State, as EJ has done a great job in talking about, quickly making the determination between do I provide services or do I provide benefits. And as the mayor of the city of Syracuse, there is nothing I can do about pensions. Albany decides how old you are, what your benefit's going to be, how you're going to accrue it, whether you get overtime, all of those things. In the two most expensive group of employees that I have, and I'm sure it's the same in Buffalo and Rochester, are police and fire. Police and fire can retire after 20 years of service, but really what they have that is very, very special is they have what's called compulsory interest arbitration. So, and for just to make it clear, as was said when I was introduced, I'm a labor lawyer by training and background. I represented unions, primarily doing work in front of the NLRB. So I know a lot about collective bargaining. In compulsory interest arbitration, if the municipality and the union come to an impasse, then an independent arbitrator is hired to decide what is in the best interest or what is fair. What has come of that is that the arbitrator inevitably tries to split the baby and gives more to the unions. And so there is no desire at all to bargain with the municipality in good faith. Let me give you a hard and fast example of what that means. In the city of Syracuse, for family medical coverage for police and fire, they're paying $27.69 a month. That means an independent arbitrator felt that that was an appropriate monthly contribution for healthcare. Those of you who are in the private sector, I dare say even those of you who are in the public sector, realize how that pales in comparison. And so my healthcare contributions go up. We budget about 9% every year. There is nothing I can do about that number because Albany has said that they are entitled to compulsory interest arbitration. Another point is that the arbitrator, in terms of weighing factors, does not have to weigh a municipality's ability to pay. So we can go and say, look at our books. There's no money. The cupboards are bare. We can't do any of this. The arbitrator doesn't have to weigh it. Doesn't have to. And so you have this incredible division, and you end up the largest expenses that we have are personnel expenses. The largest personnel expenses, 77% of our pension expenses are police and fire. Again, we have no control over that. So while I haven't read the article yet, Bruce, I look forward to reading it, you can look at it and say we're dependistan, or you can look at it and say we have this history where we came from, our economic base was manufacturing, and then manufacturing did a complete and total change in this country, and in New York State we did not have a policy to support that change. And so what we did effectively since 1950 is just try to subsidize upstate. But now all of a sudden there's no more money in New York State, and it doesn't look like that there's going to be the same kind of largesse that there traditionally has been. What I have said to the leaders in Albany and my delegation, anybody candidly who will listen to me, is I don't want your money, I want reform. And they say, whoa, 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 slow down, Mayor, slow down. But if you look at Buffalo's, the Fiscal Control Board's annual report when it first started in 2003 versus the most recent one, it's amazing. The same, the trend is the same. All the same factors, and they all say the same thing. We're dependent on more aid from the state. We're dependent on more aid from the state. We're dependent on more aid from the state. I don't want to be dependent on that, but when you tie my hands behind my back to make decisions, then, you know, now I'm in the worst of both worlds. I can't make the decisions, and you're giving me no money. And then you're going to say, you know what, it's because of poor leadership, and you guys are, you know, country bumpkins up there.